Good afternoon and welcome along to round 19 of MotoGP in 2023. Now just two contenders remain with two rounds, two Grand Prix and two sprints left to go. It's Team Pecco versus Team Martin as we find out who will be world champion in 2023 in the space of the next 10 days. Here in Qatar at the LaSalle International Circuit this weekend and next weekend at the Circuit Ricardo Turbo for the season finale. Jack Appleyard and Simon Crafe are here to talk about the title fights that is going to be swinging one way or the other in the desert this weekend. Now 14 points splitting the Italian and the Spaniard ahead of this one here in Qatar this weekend. Simon, let's get straight into it then. Another fascinating weekend in Malaysia. A Saturday in particular for me was a day of huge interest. We saw Bagnaia taking pole position for the first time in what I'm sure for him felt like a very, very long time. Importantly, beating Jorge at his own game by being able to take pole position. And then the sprint started again. Half race distance, you thought that this was Bagnaia really putting his stamp on this championship by taking pole and then sprint, stopping the streak of victories that Martin had had. It looked like it was going that way, and then it all changed. Front troubles for him. The Grand Prix itself, the big talking point was, of course, Enea Bastianini, which I feel could be another huge sort of influence in these final two rounds now that Bagnaia seemingly has a teammate that could get in the mix for victory as well. I mean, 7 days on, how do you reflect on what we saw in Malaysia last time out?
Yeah, I saw the same as you on those points. We saw Pecco have a bad chatter problem and drop back. He was clearly not happy. You know, I interviewed him for the sprint, not podium, but what is it?
It is a podium, yeah.
Okay, podium. He was clearly not happy, and he was clearly going to go back to the team and go, this happened to me, you know, we can't have that again. I was so happy to see the beast back. I've got to touch on that because I didn't feel like talking about it at the time because it's still sensitive, but I had a part in my career where things went south. We changed something serious and I could not make friends. And my results went from, maybe can fight for the championship next year after three podiums, a win. And it went, and there was talk of, they got rid of me half season, you know. Yeah. And I was watching the beast going through something similar. People talking about he's going to lose his job and horrible. And to see him come back was why I was so happy for him, you know. Didn't want to see that happen to him. And the race. Can we talk about the race?
Certainly can.
The race, the battle in the beginning, there was a proper scrap.
Fantastic.
Wasn't me. I mean, I would love to go on longer, but there was a proper fight for that fresh air, wasn't there?
Well, we're going to see it here, Simon. Yeah. This was on lap four going into lap five. This move in particular, unbelievable from Bagnaia to roll around the outside of Martin in the manner that he did. It may well have been at this point only fighting for third on track, but it felt like there was more at stake there.
Oh, definitely. I mean, there is like bragging rights there. How do you put it? Ego. To pass someone around the outside is always like saying, you're slow. You know? And he would have really enjoyed doing that. But the other bit was, to me, the important fight was about for the fresh air. You can see Jorge's in the dirty, heated air behind. Both of them want to get in front, look and get that clear air. And there was a proper fight, and Bagnaia came out on top. You know, so there's a couple of things in there that, over the weekend, like you said, pole position, then the fight, then for. For that fresh air, and he won that scrap as well. So I know there was only one point in it over the whole weekend between Jorge and Pecco, but Pecco would be feeling good about it. Jorge, not so good about losing those couple of things.
I'm racking my memory here. That feels like, despite not being for victory, the first time this year that in a head-to-head fight, Bagnaia's got the better of Martin. We think of Thailand, we think of Germany, the two standout races where the pair of them went toe-to-toe. So, as you say, it may well have only been a point gained over the course of the weekend, but in terms of momentum, did Bagnaia walk away feeling much stronger?
Yeah. Look, yes, that's how I feel. But also, Jorge will be telling himself, look, the reason I couldn't fight was because of the dirty air, and, you know, he had to drop off in the end. Said he was having some scares. And basically, they're having that scrap for that fresh air so they don't overheat that front tyre and then they can have an easier race. I mean, then that fresh air actually caused Pecco to have a warning.
Yeah.
So, and Martin to have a tougher race, you know. So these early laps are super important, and it's why we see people taking risks and having big fights early on in the race, especially those first 2 to 4 laps.
You touched on it there. It's something that we do have to mention. Following the Thai Grand Prix, we obviously came on the gear up and told you about the fact that Jorge Martin had been given his first warning for a tyre pressure offence following the Malaysian Grand Prix. There was talk before it on this show in the press conference with Bagnaia almost hinting at the fact that he has an opportunity to play his joker, to play his wild card as such. And we don't know the exact ins and outs of it, but after the race, Bagnaia was handed his first penalty, his first warning, shall we say, meaning that for the pair of them, if there was a situation in the final two rounds whereby they were under the permitted tyre pressure on the front of the bike, then they would get a 3 second penalty. We've obviously moved away from the likes of Malaysia, Thailand, Indonesia, where we saw the vast bulk of those warnings come in, purely down to the fact of the temperatures that we deal with there. We're racing at night here in Qatar. We're going to Valencia about a week out from Christmas, I'm sure it'll feel like. Temperature there is going to be much, much lower. So is the likelihood of it having this huge impact on the championship in these next two races lower than what we would have seen in those hotter countries?
Yeah, in general, it's less extreme because the track temperatures aren't going to be 50 degrees or more like we get to see in Thailand, Malaysia and India, all the really hot ones. So, like I said, it won't be as extreme. The track temperatures, that the ambient temperature is really high, and then you get the temperature off the bike, which is higher than normal as well, because they're struggling to keep them cool. All that adds up to it's more extreme things to deal with, more difficult to deal with. And you're in probably more trouble when you do get behind, especially a group. But I think it's still not easy to manage, because at the end of the day, they're trying to, crew chiefs are trying to predict the right temperature, which means they have to predict the type of race, whether they're going to be behind a group or whether they're out front.
You need a crystal ball for that.
Exactly. So it's still easy to get wrong, meaning you think you're going to be out front, but if you don't get that, it's very difficult to get out front, and you know you're going to be in big trouble if you're not. So out front means you're going to run a higher temperature, a higher pressure to be there. And then if you're behind and knowing you're going to be in a group, then you've got to run a lower one. But if you end up out front, you're going to get a penalty. So it's still not easy to manage. It's just not as extreme as the hot ones.
For some at home, this might be quite complex in terms of trying to get an understanding of how this is going to have an impact on the championship. But for the riders themselves, on their dashboard, they have an indication of what the pressure is of the front tyre.
Not everyone.
Okay. No.
Because some of them, for example, the Yamaha riders say, there's nothing we can do about it. We know it's going on because we can feel it. But at the end of the day, you might as well not be bothered about some alarm. You might as well focus on your job and your feel. So no, we don't even, I mean, they've got the impression they don't even want it. It doesn't matter. Others, they have a more, basically a light coming on, and they can adjust when that light comes on. And the light comes on when they're getting to a critical point where it's too high.
The reason I ask that is, will it change potentially how either Pecco Bagnaia or Jorge Martin attack these upcoming final two races? It's not something that we expect to have an impact in the sprints, but in the longer Grand Prix, if it was to have an impact, that's where it would. If they're out front, if they feel I'm in trouble here, this tyre pressure is going to drop, are they more likely to attack much harder and try and build up an advantage to have that safety barrier, which seems like a silly thing to say because obviously riders are trying to win as comfortably as they can normally, but there's a lot of things to maintain, whether it be the fuel load, whether it be the rear tyre, and if they feel that we could be in trouble here, I'm going to have to win by 3 seconds to be in the safe zone, could we see them maybe taking more risks to try and build up that advantage?
I don't know where to start because there is so many angles. You said about attack, and yeah, you can attack to build up the distance, which I think is what you're talking about, in case there is a time penalty. 3 seconds, if you've got more than that, doesn't matter then. You keep your position. But also, you can't afford, crew chief's told me this, you can't afford to roll off at the end of the race. Our crew chief told me you can't afford to roll off because if you're following someone, you think, I can't pass on my muzzle, relax the last couple, make sure I don't fall off. But he says the problem with that is if that person ahead gets 3 second penalty, if you're close, you're going to be ahead of them to get that position. But secondly, if you roll off, you not only drop back in the cooler air, you don't create as much temperature in the tyre, which creates, you could get a warning, you know, or a penalty. So it's like, there are a lot of things to manage here. If you push too hard, you're likely to fall off, you know. So these riders, apart from, I count on the different manufacturers, 9 buttons and levers on the left-hand handlebar. They're trying to deal with all this as well.
And the World Championship on the line as well. 14 points between them now with 2 sprints and 2 Grand Prix remaining. As we alluded to, a momentum potentially in the favour of Bagnaia given what happened at Malaysia last time out. But this is a venue that Jorge has had a lot of success at, even from his very first weekend in MotoGP.
Yes. We've spoken enough about all the technical side. Yeah. What I really love is these two riders, totally different people, you know, totally different statures, different ways of doing things, and they've ended up at the championship. I'm hoping it'll go all the way to Valencia, you know, and I like it. I noticed it a couple of races ago. I said it boiling up to be a great fight, and this is what I like I said, they're different styles, different stature, different ways of doing, different strengths, and different people, you know, which is quite fun for the fans to be able to choose what type of rider they like, you know. But I don't care, and I say that I'd really care about them. I really care about the fight that is going, but I don't care who's going to win. And I was wondering if you're going to ask me who's going to.
I never answer
the people that ask me that. I'm not interested, because what I'm happy about is we don't know. It's going to be down to who doesn't make a mistake. And the rider and the team managing all these problems the best. And what I want to see is may the best rider and team win, you know, and not for another reason. You know, I'm hoping it's not going to be taken out by someone else or something out of their control. I really want it to be down to the last and the best one, a close fight, and the best person win and team.
Interesting, if we're talking human side, who you think at this current stage is better prepared for what's coming over the next 2 Grand Prix weekends? Bagnaia, of course, has a MotoGP World Championship to his name. Yes. How important, how vital will that experience be? And the fact he was able to do it at a final round decider. Now a lot of us, we headed to Valencia last year thinking it was a foregone conclusion. But Bagnaia, in interviews following that, has spoken about the fact that he arrived at Valencia thinking only of the worst case scenario. He said the pressure got to him last year in Valencia, even though it was, 22 points, was it? Something where it needed.
And it wasn't the win, it wasn't the result you'd want at the end of the championship, you know, to win it.
No. It needed Fabio to win the race full stop. Otherwise, if he didn't, then it was Bagnaia's. But even despite that, and even despite the fact that Fabio hadn't won a race for 6 months up to that point, Bagnaia still admitted it really got to me, the pressure and the circumstance behind a season-defining race.
He doesn't have the, the advantage of the huge points this time, and instead of worrying about I only need to get 14th, I better not take a risk, he's got a fight, you know, proper fight, which is better for us, but also you've just got to focus and get on with the job. So the thing is, you're talking about the two different riders, who's more prepared. The reason I like it is Jorge's been faster in recent times. Started off the beginning of the year the opposite, which is Pecco, while Jorge was trying to figure out the bike and how to ride it in the setting. Pecco did that quickly and won straight away. Then he lost a bit of momentum after the crash in Barcelona.
Yep.
Maybe confidence, whatever it was. Then had some terrible Friday, Saturdays qualifying and, you know, struggling in the sprint, but always made it through Sunday for the big points. Now we're seeing Pecco from a few races back coming through to, he said Friday in Malaysia was his best Friday since the crash in Barcelona. So Pecco's back on form. You can feel it. You know, he's happy with the bike from Friday. And Jorge's as fast as ever. It's down to he's got a little bit less experience, obviously, less time in the championship, hasn't won a championship, but he's got the speed, and it's down to manage everything right. I believe he is learning from those mistakes, him and the team. And the old Jorge, put it this way, he would have crashed in Malaysia.
Yeah.
He would have crashed. And he felt that front going, he saved it, and he went, no, I'm going to bring it home. Backed off a little bit, trying to get some fresh air. I was proud of Jorge, the way he handled that, you know. And you might think, oh, you know, Bagnaia was better. But I just think he did what Bagnaia has always been doing recently, and that is, if you can't win, if you can't fight, bring it home. So it's right down to the line. I don't know who's going to win, and I don't care, like I said.
It was as you rightly point out, a level of maturity that perhaps we haven't seen from Jorge in his riding up until that point. I mean, you just have to look at Malaysia last year as a prime example.
Yeah.
2 seconds up the road.
He would have ignored the warnings, you know, and, and just, right, he wants to be fast. And now he's clever enough to heed the warnings, bring it home.
Absolutely. Bagnaia, though, still remains as the world championship leader, despite finishing behind him in the sprint and having his own issues in the race as well, only coming through to finish third, which remarkably is the first time this year, other than Barcelona, for quite some time, that neither Martin or Bagnaia has walked away with a sprint or a Grand Prix win. Is that just an indication of the time of year that we're at? Does that have the championship have an influence on that being the case?
Yes, but I would say that because there's so many riders riding at such a high level. That race was something like 15 seconds faster than last year. It was crazy fast. It's why it got a bit boring, because the riders at the front stretched everyone out so much. The level was so high that it would ended up a more of a procession, you know, but everybody's still on the limit, but it wasn't as exciting. But that's why I say end of the year, everybody's got their bike dialed in, they're on form, you know, they're squeezing everything out of what they've got. So to get a podium in this period is not easy.
And this weekend in particular, let's look at the LaSalle International Circuit, because it's quite vastly different to the last time we were here. Not only is there now a state-of-the-art pit complex that we're bringing you this show from, which is astounding, that multi-million pound project that looks sensational, but the circuit...
It looks like, if you wandered through here between the paddock, meaning the garages, and the new back of it, it's like you're in a commercial, like a shopping mall, but for MotoGP. It's spectacular.
It's quite the venue.
Sorry, I had to share that.
No, but the circuit itself, a brand new track surface. Mm-hmm. A lot of the talk from the riders is about this new asphalt. Formula One came here a couple of weeks ago, and there was a lot of talk about just how much degradation there was. I guess we're not going to know until tomorrow morning, but as Brad Binder pointed out, not even tomorrow morning, because really the morning sessions here are useless, because we're racing under nighttime conditions, different temperatures, the dew point and the rest as well, which means that the only real useful
in
session
green for track.
Exactly, to get ready for the sprint and the Grand Prix is going to be the hour tomorrow evening, which is going to make it arguably one of the most unpredictable of the year.
Yeah, less sessions to work with, sessions that give you the right information to prepare for the race, because those daytime ones, like you said, you don't get the information that you need. It's about, you know, learning the track, getting the cobwebs off, you know, sorting the bike out a little, but it doesn't give you the same information. It's the evening sessions that do. I'm sad to say I haven't yet ridden the track. Normally I have at this point when we're doing, but I'm happy to say I'll be riding at 6 o'clock tonight and get the first feel of that new surface. There was a lot of talk about the Formula One and how the degradation problems. For example, I went and did some digging and they had a sandstorm. And I think that was a part of the problems they had.
Right.
And when I spoke to Piero Taramasso, he doesn't believe that they are going to have problems because there isn't a sandstorm, you know. And what the information he has, and they do work preparation to find out about the surface before coming. And he believes it'll be fine. It looked bad because of the storm here.
Well, that'll be interesting because a number of riders are saying that what tyre to run on the back and the front may well be quite substantially different to the indicators that they've had from years prior, which...
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Which is going to play into the fact that it's going to be tough to call, and especially
again,
for...
down to teams and riders making the right decisions, which is, part of the job, you know?
Especially when you're fighting for a world championship, when you've just got an hour on Friday afternoon to get that motorcycle sorted. One small mistake from rider, from team, whoever it may be, will have huge consequences. But that's all to come over this weekend, round 19 of 2023, as Team Pecco versus Team Martin goes up a gear. The fight for the crown rumbles on to the desert here in Qatar. Let's hear from our two title contenders, shall we, ahead of this, the penultimate round of 2023. Pecco and Martin are with Matt Burt.